The last topic is prolonged pyrexia by our future scientific coordinator of IIM Chennai, Kodambakkam, Dr. Major V. Parthasarathy. It's a very burning problem for common general practitioners.
This year we decided on the direction of K. Subramaniam and Annachalam. We must have younger fellows, we must have some change. Therefore, last year you all of you honored me to be take over the CME and money and the report to strike towers, etc., etc. I thought we'll have a change. I will hand over the headship to this man. So he will monitor, watch the trade towers, etc., etc. Sir, you are him, you are that.
As Professor Chandrasekhar remarked, I don't know how much justice I'll be doing to the job, but let's give it a try. That is my attempt. And in fact, in this case of prolonged pyrexia, I requested my colleague at the Kalyani Hospital to present this case. This is an interesting case to see the dimensions of the problem which pyrexia can pose. We worked out this case extensively only to find a simple thing would be the final answer for this problem.
Good evening to all of you. This is a 22 years old female patient married, 2 months postpartum female patient named Lakia. Residing at Kanaki Nagar, she came to our hospital with the chief complaints of cough with expectoration and breathlessness for 1 week, continuous fever for 3 weeks, generalized body pain for 3 weeks, history of present illness. At 35 weeks of gestation, patient developed seizures. She was diagnosed with antepartum eclampsia and emergency LSTS was done. She was discharged in a stable status. That was 2 months before she came to us. She delivered 2 months before coming to us. Patient developed fever and seizures 2 weeks after delivery. She was treated in another hospital as viral meningitis encephalitis. These were the CSF analysis. So next slide. Treatment given was acyclovir for 7 days, her fever subsided, she was discharged with the advice to continue phenytoin. 3 weeks later, she developed fever again, for which she was admitted in other hospital. Outside, they have done in other hospital investigations for malaria, dengue, betan, all were negative. USG abdomen that time done was normal. Fever did not subside and hence she was referred to our hospital. There was no associated complaints of, I think you missed one. No, there was no associated complaints of vomiting, headache, no associated complaints of loose stools, burning, micturition, no ear discharge, no history of joint pain, no photosensitivity, no history of recurrent oral ulcers. There is no significant past history, not a known case of DM, HT, TB, epilepsy. No history of allergies in the past, menstrual history and marital history, regular 3x30 cycles, married since 1 year, no history of previous abortions. In examination, she was conscious, oriented, temperature 99.8, pulse 138, BP 170, these are the pulse, respiratory rate 26, saturation was normal. On examination, she was pallor, icterus was present. Regarding lymph nodes, bilateral cervical lymph nodes were palpable, firm, less than 1 cm, free from the skin, non-matted. Initially, when we examined on the first day, she had a painless lymph nodes. During her stay in the hospital, these cervical lymph nodes were tender. Similarly, inguinal and axillary lymph nodes were palpable. Facial edema was present, macular rash over neck present, oral ulcers present. No clubbing, sinusitis, thyroid swelling present, no sternal tenderness. These are pictures of the icterus and the rash over the neck. Systemic examination, RS bilateral ear entry was equal, left infrascapular occasional craggles were present, perabdominal there was diffuse tenderness, bowel sounds normal, no organomegaly, CVS and CNS were normal, fundoscopy normal. Post in the hospital, 22 years old female admitted for fever and breathlessness. We thought of a query PEO, autoimmune disorder, malignancy. She was started antibiotics with higher injection, crystalline penicillin, amikacin and metro. Other symptomatic treatment with antipyretics and antitussives were given. All opinions of neurology, gastroenterology and gynecology was taken. Investigations, total count on the first day of, that is 25th 11, when she presented to us, 5000, hemoglobin, platelet, yes sir, all were normal, all electrolytes normal. These are the serial liver function tests done. Actually I would be pointing out what we did on the 28th, which led to decrease in SGOT and SGPT, and general condition also, which was toxic at the time of admission, it got better. Similarly, the platelet count, it was decreasing along with the increase in INR, which was once 2.27, for which we had to transfuse 6 FFP to her. Urine routine was showing 10 to 12 per cells per eye power field, but the culture sensitivity, there was no growth. All tests regarding fluid, this temperature, all were negative, lepto IgM, IgG negative, RMT negative, all. ANA was low positive, but double stranded DNA was negative. Then on 28th, prothrombin time 28.3, INR was high, 2.67, EPTT high, LDH-PAP. Peripheral smear showing mild microcytic hypochromic anemia. She was showing thyrotoxicosis. Chest X-ray normal, ECG normal, echo normal, MRI brain with MRI and MRV normal. Transvaginal USG showed retroverted uterus, otherwise normal study. Patient's condition was not improving, her liver enzymes were increasing. Thyrotoxicosis was the picture in the thyroid profile. All routine tests negative. The thing which we did on 28th was, as she was on phenytoin, which was started for her viral meningitis encephalitis, we stopped the medication, as it was more than 4 weeks she was on it, more than 6 weeks actually. Next slide. Patient improved after stopping of phenytoin. She was started on steroids on 30th. 6 FFP, as I told, was given for high INR, and patient was recovering well. We made a final diagnosis of anticonvulsant hypersensitivity syndrome. I will be discussing on bit on anticonvulsant hypersensitivity syndrome.
Can I ask one question?
Yes. Just 2 minutes. This summarizing this antiepileptic drug hypersensitivity syndrome. This is a syndrome with an adverse drug reaction associated with aromatic antiepileptic drugs like phenytoin, carbamazepine and phenobarbital along with primidone. The syndrome is defined by the triad of fever, skin rash and internal organ involvement, in which liver is more commonly involved. It can also be caused by other drugs such as sulfonamides, dapsone, minocycline, terbinafine, azathioprine and allopurinol. Diagnosis of AHS may be difficult because of the variety of clinical and lab abnormalities and manifestations, and because the syndrome may mimic infectious, neoplastic or collagen vascular disorders. The incidence is approximately 1 in 3000 exposures. AHS starts with fever, rash and lymphadenopathy within the first 2 to 8 weeks after initiation of therapy. Internal manifestations include, among others, agranulocytosis, hepatitis, nephritis and myositis. AHS is associated with a relative excess of reactive oxidative metabolites of the AD. Insufficient detoxification may lead to cell death or contribute to the formation of antigen that triggers an immune reaction. Cross-reactivity among these other drugs are seen is as high as 70 to 80%. This one more advice I have to give to the family members also, that they can also be hypersensitive to this antiepileptic.
Question to Major sir, I think it is your patient. Sir, what was the protocol followed by which the patient was started on anti-epileptics for a suspected viral meningoencephalitis?
It was started in outside.
Unless the patient throws a seizure.
He had
seizure.
He had seizures and fever.
If the patient had a seizure and you withdrew phenytoin, what did you start in place?
Sir, as this was for the meningoencephalitis, we controlled that and fever. We were like, we had option of sodium valproate to start, but we thought of to wait and watch, because how much was the need for the, she was not on epileptic, not known case epilepsy. We thought of giving a chance and she didn't throw a seizures for last 1 month.
The second question is that you have described anti-epileptic drug hypersensitivity syndrome. What is the difference between Steven Johnson syndrome and this syndrome? same or second?
In this, the skin reaction which is seen in Stevens-Johnson syndrome can be seen in this. There are some cases which they have reported with the toxic epidermal necrolysis.
If it is similar to Stevens-Johnson syndrome, it is a medical emergency. Patient can die within hours of low total count. Secondly, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, the total count really falls to almost 1,000 or less than 1,000. The third thing is, you said the family also can be sensitive to genitalia. Is it reported?
It's reported.
Is it given in control study as a Tuandro Cochrane publishing? Because what you are saying is has got tremendous impact. The entire family is going to be reactive to genitalia.
It is given. It's went off. Patient.
After the occurrence of AHS associated phenytoin, carbamazepine or phenobarbital, it is important to reassess the necessity for use of an anti-epileptic drug. If seizure control is needed, then alternative drug therapy should be chosen. It must be remembered that older aromatic AEDs exhibit high degree of cross-reactivity and that primidone is metabolized. In part 2, it remains unclear whether lamotrigine might be a safe alternative in these patients because lamotrigine can also induce AHS. Because valproate is dissimilar in structure to the aromatic AEDs and has been well tolerated in patients with AHS, it is virtually considered as a safe alternative. Because a hereditary component is involved in the development of AHS, first degree relatives of patients who experience AHS should be informed about the increased risk of AHS in response to aromatic AEDs. We use the lymphocyte toxicity assay to help in the patient management. A positive test is very useful. If the patient gets a positive test for this lymphocyte toxicity assay, actually I don't know what it is, but according to the author, then the family members being advised not to continue the drug.
Is it idiosyncratic
reaction or
allergic
reaction? Pardon, sir? It is reaction.
It's
dermatology
okay was not part. We are
right. Why dermatology was not part?
Sir,
we had a clear diagnosis in our mind, so.
No.
Yeah, your point is when we had, primarily this came as a PUO. I mean, you are justified and laugh. When you asked other people also, why not ask a dermatologist to be on board also? It's a good suggestion, we take it.